Herring, first of all, they like the herring. But it's a very good piece of what's very hard to do, and you get a lot of very clumsy exposition in science fiction.
Just to give us a sense of wonder, make the guy seem pick up the guy, and make it seem like he has this whole huge history behind him.
Without spending a lot of money.
Yeah. Not spending much dialogue either. And Ben and I always use this as a touchstone. It's a talisman, what people call a talisman person now. And because we used to call this tip of the iceberg stuff, because there's a whole iceberg that we never hear about, which is about this future war. But just that little tip there gives a suggestion of it. And that's what we aspire to try and do in our own work. And I'd like to just quickly show another very brief piece of dialogue. It's my favourite bit of dialogue that Ben wrote ever on the show. And I'm surprised there isn't a fancy now they're called Unlimited Rice Pudding. So somebody should get cracking on that. Magnificent dialogue. Let's hear it from Ben Aron, which is far out here. It's not just a silly line, it's so beautiful, undercutting all this megalomania. You could do a better job with a long, tedious, cold speech about why it's bad to be an insane megalomania. He just does it like that. And speaking about very long, cold speeches, we're going to hear one of the few bits of dialogue that the script editor ever wrote on the show. So I'd written this speech, which I put into Ben's episode here, and they said, were there any problems with that speech? I said, yeah, it went on for about 3 hours. That was the problem with it, because I thought this was my big chance to get my big anti-nuclear speech in. And I showed it to Ben, because Ben didn't want to write it. Ben had been brought up in a very political household, so the last thing he wanted to do was write an agit top prop type speech. That's true, as soon as you said, you write it, Andrew. And I wrote it, and Ben looked at it and said, this speech is all very well, but it goes on for about 6 hours and 300 pages. I said, no, not nonsense. The speech isn't long enough. It'll be fine. And then they shot it, and it went on for about 6 hours and 300 pages. So believe it or not, that's the trimmed version of the speech. So we've gone from the sublime to the ridiculous, from unauthorized pudding to this long, long, weepy speech. But it was fun to write, and I'm glad we put it in there.
Moral of the story is never let your script editor write your script.
But he said, I don't want to write it. He said, write the speech for me.
I should have weapons bad.
I have time to do it. You want me to write it, what can I say? But we're very open to any input from you guys at any point. There's some hack writer at the back there. I think we might answer some questions from him. Steve, can I ask you a question quickly? How come you used a pseudonym on here?
You mean on the novelization?
Well, I just heard that you had to use some name like Martin Lidecker or something like that. John Lidecker, is it?
On the TV programs, I use my own name.
Yeah, I should hope so, yeah.
On the novelizations, I'd already done a couple of novelizations under other banners.
Right.
So I kept my novelizing name for those.
Oh, that makes sense. So your own novels were under your own name, novelizations were under a pseudonym.
So I kept two separate streams going. Yeah, everybody knows the secret now, so I don't know
why
I was wasting
time. It's very good. It's very good. I've got questions for the audience, but if the audience has got some questions for us, that would be higher, even better.
Recently, Big Finish have done the Lost Season 27, which made me wonder why, when the new adventures came along, it didn't seem to be, the script weren't novelized.
Well, the whole initiative of the new adventures was to get away from novelizations and do what they called original novels. So it would have been a retrograde step from their point of view to novelize. They'd done enough novelizations of existing scripts to novelize their non-existing scripts. Wouldn't have been very interesting at that point because they wanted to do longer, more original novels with more sex and violence in them, which is what they're up for.
Definitely. Although you did get, actually, Transit was originally script idea.
That's true, so you
did get that. Script,
well, we rejected it, but there was a Remembrance of the Daleks was even better than Transit. Transit was, it was good because what I used to do with like new writers is I'd run them past John, and he'd always want to, I suppose most executives would want to reject the first thing that you offer, so it was always good to have a kind of stalking horse like that.
Always have something that can be rejected by the producer. Of course, if you do that on purpose, they immediately accept it and you're rejected.
Yeah, then
so
you're in
trouble. Metro is sort of a certain standard just in case.
Just in case they go for it.
Safety tip there. Never trust producers. That's another safety tip.
Any other questions from the floor there? Is that high?
How pro do you feel that it would be the possibility of
could we see that clip, please? Well, you know, we were fairly proud, but then we were outraged when the wheel was reinvented, you know, when the new show came out, and we said, oh, Daleks have never gone up the stairs, and now they do. I thought, you know, this is like Stalinist Russia. They're reinventing the past, it's madness.
It was terrible, because you can't really phone in. For God's sake, you know, I did that because you said I was such a prat. So you
with a tearful voice. It was 20 years ago, I remember it so well.
Yes, the V phase must have caused an overload.
What did you say to it?
Well, I must say, one half of the dialect materialized when the other half was materializing. All two half-side codes at the same point. Absorbing reaction destroyed it.
Interesting.
I don't understand these maths.
So no more dialects can be transported from
you? Well, it's slowing down a bit until the operator can repair the systems.
The operator?
Yes, and now she's a leading operator on station in case of any more functions.
And that would be another Dalek.
Yes.
Thank you.
perfect example of the Andrew Carnival principle of teasing the audience, where you go in and you say something, you go, oh, don't worry, nothing can happen, unless, and they go, but that will be fine, and then you say, but unless that happens, and you come back, so you go backwards and forwards with the threat being...
So it's like everything's fine, unless there's a Dalek here.
And then suddenly there's a Dalek, but we run upstairs, and then there's a Dalek comes upstairs. And that's, you know, that's a fun thing to do to the audience. It was one of his principles, to say, like,
I'd forgotten what a great show of reverence was. I went into the school teacher. Kicks, surfing like that, yeah, gross, that's great. I mean, it was really, really good stuff. Was there not some line in it, some early draft where service is something, they said something like, oh, but it'll never be able to climb the stairs? Do we have that in there?
I can't remember if we actually had that line in
there. Well, if we had it, it would have been silly because there's no time in the action for somebody to actually say that. But it's great. I forgot that we had the creepy school superintendent or whatever. It was fantastic. So I love Remembers. I bet you did a fantastic job on that. Any questions about Remembrance, guys?
BBC books are kind of the being audio, you know, narrated audio versions of the old novelizations. But Remembrance of the Daleks haven't been.
More cash for Ben. I think that sounds like a good idea. Put that on.
No, they haven't approached me. I don't know anything about that. So
feel free to approach Ben.
Feel free to start a letter writing campaign. I'm right behind the letter writing campaign. In fact, I'll give you a template. I'll put it up on my website. You can, dear BBC, please give more money to Ben. You know, it's funny. No, the BBC don't like me. I've just come to this conclusion.
Nobody's paranoid.
I'm not paranoid or anything. It's always whenever they release these things, it's like, well, release this, release Ben, and release that. And I'm beginning to think. But actually, I think it's got more to do with state problems. I would suspect anything to do with Daleks has to be.
Termination, yeah, that could be.
Termination, and Hancock hates me, and so, well, Hancock, I don't know, Hancock's dead, isn't he?
I say to Ben, you're paranoid. He says, is that what they're saying about me now?
As far as I know, they saw the first draft, and the first draft had Scaro getting the finger. I knew three things at the beginning of the whole Doctor Who process. Was one, it was going to be set in 1963. Two, Ace was going to beat up a Dalek with a baseball bat at some point.
What could be better?
And three, Scaro was going to go boom, boom, and yeah. And that was all I knew, right? Basically, at the beginning of when I started writing it. And it's there from the very first outline. Scaro goes boom, boom. And so when I read stuff, say people say, oh, they set the draft. Now, I've heard that J&T left the end off or something, but actually,
that's
I think...
That's nonsense. You just shut the stuff out.
I know exactly what happened. This is just Terry and Hancock didn't read to the end. They just didn't read to the end and think, oh, yeah, that's okay. And
I think they probably did read it, and nobody cared. So what's the story now that somebody's upset?
The idea is that it wasn't sent to them, and they didn't see it.
And this idea comes from where?
I don't know, I just read on the internet.
No, there's a fake Scaro.
Yes, someone...
It was a fake Scaro.
But it doesn't matter, because Scaro existed before that. You still have all the, you know, Daleks doing this stuff before that. It just gets blown up at a certain point. I don't understand why it clears off story possibilities.
I'm not going to explain it to you and I'll tell you about John Peel. He doesn't know about John Peel. We kept John Peel from.
I should hope so. Yeah. He's not very well detailed.
He's got delicate sensitivity, so we just try to.
So, any further questions about that? Oh, we're high. Yep.
If you'd been invited to come back and write another Dalek story, where do you reckon you'd have gone?
I wanted to do a story, which I think would work very well actually in the context of the new series, although they'd never give it to me, it is where you know, just because it's I think they've overdone the Daleks. I think they're a bit sick of the Daleks, so I don't think they want to do a Dalek story. But yeah. I wanted to do a Dalek story where you arrive and there's this huge fleet bombarding this planet to death. And you get down and it's the Dalek homeworld. The Daleks have been reduced to this remnant population. And it's sort of like you turn the tables. The Daleks are now the oppressed.
That's great.
The oppressed kind of like a genocidal minority. And human beings and all the allied races have turned up and they're going to wipe them out. So the Doctor has to then save the Daleks. You can call it Savior of the Daleks.
It's a classic Ben Rose one, I love it. Yeah.
And that was actually one of the ideas I had when they wanted me to pitch a Dalek story. And it wouldn't have worked for that series because they couldn't afford the really kick-ass special effects. But it would work now, you see, because you could have big explosions, which is very important. You'll probably notice there's a trend in my writing. It's like, every so often something must go boom. Okay.
I'm upset.
Any other questions, Alex?
Isn't it very unfair to the fowls who also live on Skyrim to wipe the planet?
I'm glad you asked that question, because I checked with Ben about that. He's got an answer for that.
Yes, it never occurred to me that the fowls had left at that point. For me, you don't put a line saying, oh, thank God the fowls have all left, because it just never occurred to me the Doctor would blow up Skaro if the fowls were still there. Go around in the script when you're like dotting your eyes and something you can see, otherwise you end up with a script which is full of things like, I've crossed the road, but there are cars coming, so I won't cross the road, I'll stay in it. You know, you can't, I just assume the thousand, but because you've got to remember, for most 99% of the actual audience of that show, they wouldn't know who the thousands were anyway.
Thank you.
So you'd have to add an explanation that would just be, what? 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 And then that would be it. So,
except what rice pudding lines that they say.
Yes, that's it. And they say, like, the fowls, are they eating the rice pudding? Are these the people with the unlimited rice pudding? This is the important stuff.
There's no
fowls
in Destiny of the Daleks, so they probably have to
be fighting. Well, also, I assume, you don't see them in Destiny of the Daleks, so yeah. They've gone.
Does gentlemen hear the question?
Is there any different writer for Torchwood than Doctor Who?
Well, if you look at Doctor Who, it was always a series, it was a three-parter or a four-parter. Torchwood is just a one-off self-contained episode, so in a way, it was more like just a pure single story. So that, from a basic structure point of view, was more straightforward. Slightly less science fiction, I'd say, Torchwood. It's got a lot of science fiction paraphernalia going on in it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
More money. Yeah.
I'm just really interested to know why you put the Edge of Darkness ending
in there. Well,
should
we? Okay.
We've got all of it, you see. We wanted a bit, but we've got to specify which bit, so it's not really.
But you've chosen a random, chosen one of my favourite bits. The idea was to have Wen Chiang, which has summarised all the sort of beautiful influences that we got from Doctor Who. I mean, we couldn't show everything, but that was a great high point. Then we had clips from Ben's stories. Battlefield and Daleks, but also we wanted to show what was really influencing us at the time when we were doing Doctor Who. And I don't know if anybody ever saw Edge of Darkness, but we could take a quick look at this because we loved it. And it was our hero was the guy who wrote it, Troy Kennedy Moore.
Yes, a god.
It was a god.
I'm with my man Sam. Anyone might send me an head on. I don't see the point of moving from this spot. Yes, great. The bastards could this as we can. Why? Because they don't have our eyes.
He wrote some fantastic feature books. The one that you would have heard of would be The Italian Job. But Edge of Darkness was his noir masterpiece that had just come out before I joined the BBC, and Ben was a big fan of it, so that was sort of represented a high watermark in the writing.
It was also a very good illustration, which you can't see from that clip. I don't know, who knows Edge of Darkness, who's ever seen it?
Hey, good.
Okay, I will do a quick pressing. Edge of Darkness is a policeman whose daughter is killed. For the first three or four episodes, the daughter as a ghost follows him around quite a lot. And the big breakthrough for me was when I realised that Troy Kennedy Martin had done this so that the main character can explain the plot to someone. Because that way, then you can have a loner and have him talk to someone.
It's
like having an invisible sidekick. So she's just there when he needs to explain how telephone intercepts work or who such a guy he knew in MI6 was. And then when he doesn't do it, she goes away. And you don't have to explain anything, you don't have to give her any backstory, and you can make it all kind of sob story and everything. And that's a very efficient piece of storytelling, is when you can make a character fulfill several functions at once. And a lot of people would have done that, several characters would have had a sidekick, and the daughter would have been dead, so they would have been seeing flashbacks of his daughter, and he would have had a sidekick to talk to. And Troy Kennedy Martin obviously went, no, I'll just make them both the same character, and then we don't have to pay someone, I can pocket that money as well.
Yeah, but you have a tighter and better script.
It also makes it much tighter and better script. The money's important, the money's always great.
It's a lot better than the Bell Gibbs and Greenway.
Yeah, you know, when I saw the Bell Gibson remake, I sort of didn't like it at all, but then I watched it again, and I was quite impressed, because it had to be so different, because it was only 90 minutes long or whatever. And I've come around to think the Bell Gibson remake was interesting, but it left behind almost everything, you're right, with the original. It's very true.
Well, the problem was that you had that wonderful 80s paranoia. In the 80s, you just never really going to be, it's like an era, it's like the 60s, the 80s, you know, it was very, you had that very dark paranoia kind of sense of the secret state, and also the fact that that was a period where we were still sitting 15 minutes from all being blown to pieces, and that had an influence on just about everything we did. I'm writing a character for my current book, and people say, how difficult is it to write the character? And the most difficult thing to write about the character is who was born in 1985 and doesn't know what I'm talking about. When I talk about that, doesn't know, you know.
Doesn't have any of the
green or common. Doesn't know what green or common is, or, you know. And that kind of idea, people go, oh, the world's a terrible place, and you think, I grew up, it was going to explode. And it's got better since then. So I'm slightly optimistic.
Any other questions
from anybody?
Oh.
It's a general question.
I'm a former
script editor. Is there anything about the new series you don't like
it,
how you do it differently? Just personally
speaking,
not to be critical
of the new series,
but what,
there's a couple of other new series. Probably to put the best face on it, when I was most avidly watching it during the first few seasons, I really wanted something different. My favourite scripts were Moffat's scripts, and I liked those very much. I thought it made sense for him to take over the show, and I did feel that. I don't want to get into knocking individual scripts, because I know some of the writers had a hell of a time, and what ended up on the screen wasn't really their vision. So I don't want to say Joe Boggs' script for X was rubbish, because Joe Boggs is rewritten by everybody. Damn, poor guy. So I'd say that the Moffat ones I thought were great. And I also thought that it really began. By the time Russell did his third season, there was a script like Gridlock, which I really liked, and the one about the hospital on the moon, is it called Smith and Jones or something? Those first several of that season, which were awesome, were wonderful, but I thought the first couple of seasons took a while to get going, I wasn't that impressed. So that's kind of me being diplomatic and also complimentary about the show. I hope it's not too guarded for you. Oh, Lisa, hi.
Since this is brought up, Stephen Moffat, were you actually aware of his early work when you were actually working
as
script editor of Doctor Who, would you have hired him?
No, I wasn't aware of him or Russell or Paul, who all were apparently knocking around at that time. And anybody who sent stuff in, we would have got a look at. But it was very difficult for anybody to make the jump from the slush pile up from the, you know, the unsolicited scripts. The guy who did do that, magnificently though, was Mark Platt. And he did a wonderful job. The great thing about Mark Platt was he was working at the BBC, and anybody else who had been working at the BBC at that time would have sent me their material in an internal BBC envelope, thinking, you know, this will help me get it. But he didn't do that. He just sent it in from the outside with no trace of him being a BBC fellow employee. And so when I called this guy, he said, well, actually, I'm working at the BBC just around the corner. And I was such a